Hello everyone and welcome to lecture 4. This time we're going to be talking about color separations. We'll talk about correcting for ink impurities or deficiencies in process colors. And we'll talk about some ways to fix those ink impurities or deficiencies with undercolor removal and or gray component removal. So as a bit of a refresher, let's just take a look at additive and subtractive color theory again. With additive color, we have an emissive device, a monitor or a screen of some sort that's blasting color out towards our eyes, and when our retina sees certain wavelengths, then we interpret that as certain colors. And for that system to work, all that device needs is red, green, and blue pixels emitting light in different brightness values, and using the combination of that increasing light, we can achieve pure white. And the absence of any light coming from that screen would appear black to us. The other system, in CMYK, or I should say in subtractive color, we have layers of pigment put down on top of typically a white substrate or something close to white. The paper or substrate is going to reflect light from whatever light source there is in our environment. That light's going to be filtered through the pigments of ink. Kind of like when you wear colored sunglasses, certain wavelengths of light are going to make it through to your eyes and it's going to make everything look that color. We subtract out more and more wavelengths of light, or more and more colors, more and more intensities of light, and we're going to get dark black. So just a quick review there. Now, color separations involve a little bit of both of those concepts. We have cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. These are typically something that you guys are all very familiar with, I'm sure. You've seen the idea of a color separation. You can click on color channels in Photoshop and look at this in a CMYK image, but blending together certain values of those four process colors is going to give us a full color image. You can see on the graphic on the right, the final CMYK full color image, whether that's an actual blended image or close-up detail view of the halftone dots, same thing, we can simulate colors by building with just those four things. Now, the way that works is kind of a combination of additive and subtractive color theory, because what our eyes see is the additive color, what's happening on the paper with the pigments of ink, that's subtractive color. So the yellow ink, what's actually happening with that yellow ink is that it's absorbing blue light. That's the whole purpose of yellow ink, is to absorb the blue. And it's going to reflect the red and the green. So that what makes it to our retina and the cone cells in there is red and green light, which our eye interprets as yellow. The cyan, same thing, it works kind of the same way, it's absorbing the red light. And it's reflecting the blue and the green. And a combination of blue plus green looks like cyan to us. And magenta is the same thing. It absorbs green, it reflects the red and blue, and red plus blue together, that looks like magenta to our eye. Now, black ink is an additional color that we need to add to that system. And there's many reasons that we'll talk about this. We're going to get into it a little bit more later on. I put a really eye-catching black square graphic there just to make you stop and pause and read the bullet points here. But if we look at the way that those cyan, magenta, and yellow combine, each one of those in a perfect system would absorb 1/3 of each of the full spectrum wavelength of visible light. So if we combine all three of those together, we should get pure black. But it doesn't work that way because the inks are not perfect. So there are deficiencies or weaknesses in that pigmentation, which we'll talk about in a minute, that are going to lead to problems. So to solve for those problems, we add black ink, and that's going to result in several different efficiencies we'll talk about in a minute. So we talked about how cyan works briefly a second ago. It reflects the blue and green, so it looks like cyan to us. The problem is that it's not perfect. It doesn't subtract all the red like it should. There's some red that slips through. And the result of that is that it kind of washes out that cyan. It's not as saturated. It grays it out. And we'll talk about this a little bit when we talk about neutral color values in a bit. But the graphic on the right-hand side shows you on the square on the left-hand side is the simulation of cyan ink on paper with a little bit of red bleeding through. That's what it would look like. On the right-hand side, that really bright saturated cyan, that would be the pure cyan color. So that's typically known as gray error or cyan gray error. Magenta has a similar deficiency, except that it doesn't let a little bit of one color through. It really effectively subtracts out the green. Problem is that it lets a little bit more red through than blue. And so, or it reflects more red than blue light, I should say. And so that's going to cause a little bit of a hue shift and give you a little more red color cast than a true magenta. And we get the same thing, same problem with yellow. Yellow is not perfect either. It does subtract out the blue really well, but it lets it a little bit too much red through. And so process yellow is a little bit warmer than it necessarily should be in a pure yellow. So there are systems that are designed to solve for this. And for example, the standards that we use for printing, swap, Grackle, and so on, they take that into account, the deficiencies of those inks. So we don't necessarily have to think about these things too much in depth, but it's important to just consider. So the specifications for different tints of gray, if we were to take a 75% gray, then building that is going to require 75% black, 75% cyan, 63% magenta, and 63% yellow, because the magenta and the yellow behave a little bit differently. We're going to need a little increased cyan to compensate for that and get the same values. And you can see going down through the 50 and 25% values as well to get those grays, we're not going to use equal proportions of those colors. Now to fix that a little more, we're going to talk about something else here in a bit. But you guys have all done this before. Think back way back to grade school when you played with fingerprints or anything. If you mix together a bunch of those paints, acrylic paints, finger paints, oil paints, whatever, it's difficult to get a solid, dark, rich black using a combination of colors. It just doesn't work that way. The cyan, magenta, and yellow just don't absorb all the light energy. So if some energy, some light, some visible spectrum is being reflected off of those inks, then it's going to look like a color to us. There's going to be a color to it. It's not going to be black. If we add that black ink to the mix, then that just sucks up all the remaining light, and it really is a true black. We have the absence of color. The black color separation increases the density in the image and the shadows and gives you more contrast. It's going to hide register problems in the image, misalignment between the plates. It's going to give outline to the details, meaning it's going to make the image overall appear sharper. And most importantly for what we're talking about today is it's what allows us to do undercolor removal or gray component replacement. Another thing to consider with the black ink is that we use process inks, and this goes for all the process colors that we use, is that they're semi-transparent. In order for them to function, they need to be semi-transparent. Some of the light has to pass through them, hit the paper, and be able to reflect back in order for this to function. An opaque black ink would not work properly. So sometimes you might want to use a very opaque ink because of its appearance in text and so forth. But that would be detrimental to the print quality for color images like a photograph or something. So UCR, undercolor removal. What this is a process for achieving some better contrast and a larger gamut in our print, while at the same time using less ink, which in turn is going to dry faster. And ink that dries faster and you don't need to use as much of it, obviously is going to cost less. So the way it works is we substitute the black ink for the other colors in shadowed areas that are neutral already. So we'll look at a picture maybe that will illustrate kind of how this is happening a little better than just that verbal description. But the next iteration of this is increasing the complexity a little bit, but also increasing the benefits of it, is called gray component replacement, or GCR. So what that does is it substitutes the black for those three process colors in neutral areas throughout the entire image, rather than only in the shadow areas. So again, we'll look at this in a graphic on the next slide, but just the thing to consider is that those process colors can be expensive. Cyan, magenta, and yellow, those all have different prices, and each of those is all more expensive than black. It's the cheapest one. So using this GCR method is going to solve a lot of problems in terms of cost and speed and efficiency. But also it can reduce metamerism. And I have a couple of slides with other benefits of it, but we'll get to that. So here's the thing I want you to think about is this concept of a gray component. So I'm going to move my mouse around here and point at this. This purple right here can be made two different ways. One way to create this is to build it using cyan, magenta, and yellow at these values, 100, 70, and 40. So this combination of colors is going to yield that color purple. Or we could build it using two colors plus black. So this 40% ink value right here, 40% of cyan we can cut out, 40% of the magenta we can cut out, because the hue is actually made just using these two colors. And then the density, the tone, I should say, how light or dark it is made using a tertiary color. This third color doesn't control the hue. So we could subtract that 40 from the other two primary colors that are made, that are used to build that hue, and replace that whole 40% with just black. That's called the gray component. That tertiary color, that third color value, combined in equal proportions is what gives us gray, right? If we have equal 40, 40, 40 of those three, then that should be gray. So the way this works is we just say, take all three of those out, replace it with 40% black, which is going to be gray. And we get the same value for less cost, faster drying, less total ink coverage, and on and on. Here's a more visual example of this taking place. On the left-hand side, you see undercolor removal, which, again, remember, it's replacing those CMY values in the neutral shadow areas. And you can see in this image that those areas where it's being replaced are just the darker parts of the image. On the right-hand side, with gray component replacement, you can see that much more of the image is being replaced. Both of these, just to illustrate, explain what you're looking at, these are just simulations in Photoshop of UCR and GCR. The right-hand side is GCR. And all these gray values throughout the image, that's what's being replaced by black. And the colors that you see, that's all the colors that you'd still need to have CMY builds to create, which I think if you look at the thumbnails, which if you can see that, might illustrate better, the darkness of the cyan, magenta, and yellow plates on GCR is much less than the darkness in cyan, magenta, and yellow on the UCR version. So you're going to use more black ink over here in GCR, but you use a lot less of the other colors. So again, I said I was going to list a bunch of advantages, and not to go into this too much, but some big benefits are listed here. So you're going to have increased color space, because if you think about it, if you take yellow, for example, on a piece of white paper, and you want to make more yellow, you can add more yellow ink from white all the way to solid 100% yellow coverage on that paper. But if you want to make it darker, then you're going to need to either add equal parts cyan and magenta to that yellow to decrease the brightness value. It's going to cut out more light. But that's less efficient than simply adding black. We can add black, and then we have the cyan and magenta left to do more with. We have an increased color space, larger gamut. Because we're changing tonal values throughout that, using black instead of using mixes of other colors, we're going to get fewer hue shifts, which is a big plus as well. We're getting more accurate color. Dot gain variation just doesn't matter quite as much. Our grays are more consistently neutral because, again, we're building our grays using mainly black rather than using a build of other colors. Because that black is being overprinted over everything else at the end, we get fewer register problems. Browns, which brown is just a dark yellow. Brown can cause moiré problems occasionally. And so using GCR is going to reduce that. Overall, the whole goal of GCR is to reduce ink coverage, which saves money. But it's also going to reduce problems with trapping, where that's where you put wet ink on top of wet ink. It's going to reduce that problem because we're having less ink going down. And when there's less ink going down, we can use much thinner substrates. So there's some benefits to it for sure. There are some limitations too, though, things that you should be aware of. Looking at the plates at press or the individual color separations can be confusing because you'll see that the black plate isn't just an outline that's adding contrast. It's going to be a really dense, thick print. And the builds of cyan, magenta, and yellow are going to be much lighter than typically what people are used to seeing. The software can vary, so there's different ways of calculating a GCR, and the way that the software handles that can be different. So that's one thing that can be an issue or limitation. Depending on how long the press run is and the percentage of a gray component replacement that's taking place, that advantage can diminish a bit. If there's too much GCR taking place, more than 70%, then what's going to happen is there'll be abrupt transitions in those color values, especially in the shadows, that are going to result in banding, and it's going to look bad. Again, if you're working with text, you're going to want lots of contrast in your text, which increases its readability and appearance, but that can have a negative effect on images too. And excess GCR can affect the glossiness and the saturation in some prints. So just some things to be aware of.